want to share about them today. If you go to Numbers chapter 19 and in verse 14, I'll start in 14. This is the law. When a man dieth in a tent, all that come into that tent and all that is in the tent shall be unclean 7 days. Okay, this is a law. We're not here dealing with laws today. But this was the law of God. If somebody died in a room, everyone that entered that room became ceremonially unclean. Everything that was in the room became unclean. Here's another one in verse 15. And every open vessel which hath no covering bound upon it is unclean. So God is talking about vessels that are open, have no covering. So the issue of covering is not new. It's been established from generation to generation. If anyone touches the unclean vessel, they become unclean. Now let's take a look at 2 Corinthians chapter 4 and verse 7. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 7. But we have this treasure in earthen vessels. There we see the word vessel again. Every open vessel that became, it was in a place of death, became unclean. And I want to say today that every vessel of God that has no covering is open to contamination. Amen? Do you understand what I'm saying? And God says, but we have this treasure in earthen vessels. So God is talking about you and I. We are the earthen vessels, and we ought to have a covering over us, that the power may be of God, and or that the excellency of the power may be of God and not of us. God wants to demonstrate his power, that he puts a covering over us. Israel needed a covering when they journeyed through the wilderness into the promised land. We also need a covering. It is, you're free. God has given you freedom to move out from under his covering. And people have done, amen. Remember Naomi, the woman, the mother, or the mother-in-law of Ruth. Naomi lived in Israel and there was a famine. And she thought it wise to move into a neighboring territory, and so she did with her family. But she was moving out from under the covering that was over Israel. So she moved out and lost all her children, because she was no longer in the covering. Now she realized and wanted to move back, and Ruth moved back with her. Like Naomi, she blamed God for what had happened. But in actual fact, Naomi was to blame because she left the covering of God. There are 8 types of covering. And I start with the first one, the blood covering. The blood covering. In the Old Testament, let's look at Exodus chapter 12, verse 7. Exodus 12, 7. And they shall take of the blood and strike it on the 2 side posts, on the upper door posts of the houses, wherein they shall eat it. God was preparing Israel to move out of Egypt. And he said, you will cover, you will strike the doorposts and the lintels of your house with blood, the blood of bulls and goats. Okay? And the blood, I'm in verse 13 now, and the blood shall be to you for a token upon the houses where you are. And when I see the blood, I will pass over you, and the plague shall not be upon you to destroy you when I smite the land of Egypt. So God said, when I see the blood of bulls and goats, I will pass over. That means the blood that has been put on the doorposts and lintels of their homes became a covering. That is why it didn't pass by, but passed over. Okay? Now here's the thing. Let me go to another scripture, Exodus chapter 24, verse 8. Exodus 24, verse 8. And Moses took the blood and sprinkled it on the people and said, behold, the blood of the covenant which the Lord hath made with you concerning all these words. So, a blood covering. Now we come to the blood of Jesus. The blood of Jesus was shed once and for all time. The blood of Jesus is a better covering than the blood of bulls and goats. The blood of Jesus is a protective cover over us. Now, they sprinkled blood of bulls and goats upon the people. We cannot sprinkle the blood of Jesus upon each other. But we can plead the blood. See, when we plead the blood of Jesus, we are asking Jesus to remember, or asking the Father to remember what Jesus did once and for all time. So we need to learn to plead the blood of Jesus. Now, I know there are places you go, you say, I plead the blood of Jesus, and like a chorus, everybody says, the blood of Jesus. It's in understanding. It's in believing. It's in having faith that the blood of Jesus has been shed so that evil will pass over us. Amen? It's not an assumption. It's something we do. Plead the blood of Jesus over your mode of transport when you're getting into it. Amen? I plead the blood of Jesus. It's a covering over you. Amen? It will ensure that no evil will come into your dwelling place. So plead the blood of Jesus Christ often. I was on an aircraft yesterday. The first thing we do is we plead the blood of Jesus. I pleaded over the flight crew, over the cabin crew, over every passenger. I plead the blood of Jesus over the aircraft. Amen? Don't take things for granted. Jesus shed his blood so that we can walk in freedom. The blood covering. The second covering is the prayer covering. The prayer covering. A prayer covering enables us access the promises and provisions of God. A prayer covering is built by your prayer to God. That's one way to develop a prayer covering over your life. Don't contract out prayer. Amen? Come before the King yourself and lift your petitions up to him. One way. A prayer covering also is built by the intercession of others. As people pray for you, a prayer covering is established that begins to help you have access to the promises and the provision of God. Amen. A prayer covering can also be built by people who have authority in your life. Okay? Your father, your mother, especially when you're still young. They are authority figures in your life. So when they pray over you, it builds a covering over your life. Amen? Are you with me this morning? And we see in Acts, in the book of Acts chapter 3 verse 1, we see Peter and John. Peter and John went up together into the temple at the hour of prayer. There must be a time, at least an hour I believe, and I'm not going to legislate, when we go up into the place of prayer and build a covering of prayer. Amen. And the apostles in Acts chapter 6 verse 4 said, but we will give ourselves continually to prayer and to the ministry of the word. The disciples understood, the apostles understood the need for continuous prayer. It builds a covering. So when you're trying to access the promises and provisions of God and there's no prayer cover, it becomes hard. Amen. Let me go to another one in the book of Acts. Peter, therefore, was kept in prison, but prayer was made without ceasing of the church unto God for him. And you know what happened? He was set free by the supernatural power of God from prison because God was answering the prayers that were made unto him by the church. Paul captures this in Ephesians chapter 6 verse 18. He says, praying always with all prayer and supplication in the Spirit, and watching thereunto with all perseverance and supplication for all saints. Prayer. 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 Philippians chapter 1 verse 4. Again, Paul writing to the church says, always in every prayer of mine for you all, making requests with joy. So we see that the prayer cover is built by the time we spend in prayer before God, also by the time others, particularly those in a position of authority over us, spend before God praying for us, and then by the prayer of those that stand in the gap in intercession. But we need to have a prayer cover over our lives. The third covering, and I know Pastor Nathaniel Bassey was here a few weeks ago, and he talked about this. The worship covering. The worship covering. He told you about the word hallelujah, and he started a month of the hallelujah challenge. Yada, Toda. These are all acts of worship. And what does a worship covering do? It brings you into a dimension of God that you couldn't access on your own. When you worship God, he opens doors that can't be opened except by him. Amen? It brings the glory of God over you. Amen? It brings God's glory into your life. So the things that would not be possible normally become possible. So what have I talked about today? The blood covering. I plead the blood of Jesus. I plead the blood of Jesus. The prayer covering. Don't eliminate prayer in your life. I know people who will come and say, Pastor, can you pray for me about this, that, and the other? And that's a responsibility. That's a good thing to ask your pastor to pray for you, because your pastor is in a position of authority over you. But having done that, you go and sit down and you don't pray yourself. Amen? You need also to pray, because that is contracting prayers to others. Amen? The next covering was the worship covering, when we can abandon ourselves in worship before the Lord. And we're going to have another, we're going to have a 12-hour Friday worship session very soon. We're just trying to put everything together, get the people that are going to come and help us along with the voice of His light. Because we will access things that we can't normally access when we get into the place of worship. Worship brings glory. In Isaiah chapter 61 verse 3, he says, to appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, to give them beauty for ashes, the joy, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness, that they might be called the trees of righteousness and the planting of the Lord, that He might be glorified. God gives worship. It takes away heaviness. It takes away everything that the devil has tried to load upon you. Number four, grace. Grace is a covering. Amen. We see God. Let me read Psalm 105, just a few verses. Psalm 105 from verse 13 to 15. When they went from one nation to another people, He suffered no man to do them wrong. Yea, He reproved kings for their sakes, saying, touch not my anointed and do my prophets no harm. Israel would turn away from God, but He never turned away from them. Grace has been described as God's riches at Christ's expense. If you understand the grace of God, then you will position yourself to receive His grace. See, there are levels of grace. You can grow from one level to another. It's all about opening yourself to allow Him to have His way in your life. And if we fail to press in to take the promises of grace, there's always somebody else waiting in the queue. And they will jump in because they know how to press in and receive that which belongs to them. It is God's blessing to you at Christ's expense. Now, one of the biggest things the devil tries to do with us is to lay guilt on us. You're not good enough. You don't qualify. But the grace covering says you don't need to qualify. Jesus qualified, and therefore you are acceptable in His sight. Amen. Number five is the love covering. Let me read from 1 Peter chapter 3, verses 8 to 13. Finally, be ye all of one mind, having compassion one of another. Love as brethren, be pitiful, be courteous. If you can love your neighbor, if you can love your neighbor with the kind of love that God loves you, it establishes a covering over your life. In verse 9, not rendering evil for evil or railing for railing, but contrariwise blessing. What's God saying? When somebody does you evil, do not answer with evil, but contrariwise bless. And I know it's just human nature. And many of us still respond by human nature. That when somebody does you wrong, you're going to deal with them. You're going to show them. But by so doing, we do not bring a covering of God's love over our lives. Verse 10. For he that will love life and see good days, let him refrain his tongue from evil and his lips that they speak no guile. Let him eschew evil and do good. Let them seek peace and ensue it. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous and his ears are open unto their prayers. But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. And who is he that will harm you if ye be followers of that which is good? And I like that verse. And who is he that will harm you if you are followers of a loving God, of a God who loves? If you follow him and love your neighbor like yourself. When we walk in love, there's a love covering over us. And God says, who is he that will harm you when you are covered with his love? Amen. Number 6. God's anointing puts a cover over your life. The anointing covers. Amen. And God, an anointing, the anointing is an enablement to do whatever God has assigned you to do. And here's the thing. God anoints us not just to break through, but to break out. And I'm believing God for a breakout anointing in this house. Amen? When you can break out from the things that have bound you down, that have held you back, you can break out. Amen? The Lord puts a covering over you. You can break out on every side. People abuse the anointing. You see, God will not repent of that which he has done. If God puts a gift into your life, he will not remove the gift because you have departed from his way. But the gift will continue to work. I see a lot of the merchandising of God's anointing in this day and age. I don't know what you would do. I'd be afraid if they brought a dead body here and God raised that dead body by telling me to tell the person, arise. Some people will go and print a new business card. Dead raising anointing in the house. You see? And I begin to see people that claim the power to heal and deliver to themselves. And do not give it to the Lord. There's not one dead body that can be raised. There's not one sickness that can be healed by human power. Okay? Even the doctors say, we care. God heals.
So an anointing will come on your life to enable you to do what God wants you to do. And as long as you move in that anointing, that covering will be over your life to protect you and the assignment that God has given you. Amen? In Isaiah chapter 10, verse 20, it says, "And it shall come to pass in that day that the remnant of Israel and such as are escaped of the house of Jacob shall no more again stay upon him that smote them, but shall stay upon the Lord, the Holy One of Israel, in truth." What the scripture is saying is the old things will pass away. You're looking to men, you're depending upon men will go, and you will stay upon the Lord, the Holy One of Israel. The next one, number 7, is the glory covering. And I love Psalm 91 for this. The glory covering. First of all, verse 1 says, "He that dwelleth in the secret place of the Most High shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty." To have God's glory come upon you, you must learn to dwell in His presence. It's not hard. It's just your commitment and your dedication to God. And you're making time to spend with Him. But here is verse 4. I'll skip the other verses. "He shall cover thee with His feathers, and under His wings shalt thou trust. His truth shall be thy shield and buckler." He will cover thee with His feathers. Feathers are a type of God's glory. So when God... When the scripture says He will cover you with His feathers, it is saying He will put His glory upon you. And you know, God does not share His glory with sickness. If the sickness in your body and God's glory comes upon you, it must bow. Amen? It can't stay. And He says, you will learn to trust Him. His glory is on you. I met a man recently, and he's just such a simple person. He's a minister. And a few years ago, God moved into his church. I mean, literally, God moved in. He was at a service in his church in Houston, Texas. And he was just about to invite a guest that he had brought called Tommy Tenney. Some of you know him. You've read his book, The God Chasers. The book was inspired by the experience that this man called Richard Hurd had. He was just about to invite him when the doors flung open. And a crowd came in. And nobody could stand in that church. And the crowd came to the pulpit, crowd over the pulpit, and the pulpit was split perfectly in two. It's still there in the church. And this man, before this experience, had had 13 heart bypasses. The doctors had said, anytime you could go. And he saw Jesus in this cloud. Jesus invited him and said, "Come, put your hand into my side." And he said when he looked at the side of Jesus, it was like there were diamonds around the side. And he put his hand in. He thought maybe for about 40 minutes, he didn't have any idea of time. But when it ended, he'd spent 7 hours just frozen with Jesus. He's not had a heart problem since. He's 90 days, people were coming from all over the place and just in that cloud. He had to go to the Lord and beg him to just lift this cloud, because the people he felt still needed to be raised to the level where they could handle the kind of things that were happening in the church. When God's glory comes, earth must bow. The natural must bow. And God's glory takes, is supreme. Amen. He will cover you with his feathers because you have come to know him, because you learn to abide in the secret place of the Most High. You've entered the place where you will say, not my skills or my education or my contacts, but you will say, the Lord is my refuge. It's him I run to, not my uncle, not my daddy. He is my fortress. That's my impregnable place. He is my fortress. In him will I trust. Somebody is going to see the glory of God today. Amen. 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 So what I talked about, the blood covering, the prayer covering, the worship covering, the grace covering, the love covering, the anointing covering, the glory covering. These are all things that you have a part to play with. You can increase the covering over your life depending upon your response to God. The last one is the ministry covering. The ministry covering. Now, you have a ministry. It is not people that are called apostles, prophets, pastors, evangelists, teachers alone that have a ministry. Your ministry is whatever assignment God has given you. That is your ministry. And because you have a ministry, God puts a covering over you. A ministry covering comes over all those, well, let me put it this way, a ministry covering is provided by the ministry and all those associated with it. Let me give you a story. Remember, Jesus was hungry. It was legitimate for Jesus to be hungry. He was hungry and he was walking away from Jerusalem and he saw a fig tree with leaves. And he said, let me go and see if there are any figs on this tree. But the Bible says it was not the season for figs. So he shouldn't, by all natural indications, have expected to meet figs on the tree. He shouldn't. But he gets to the tree and he looks for figs. Why? There were not supposed to be figs on the tree at that season. But here's the thing. You have seasons in your life. I have seasons in my life. But the King of Glory does not have any season in his life. Amen? If Jesus expects figs, then the tree has a responsibility to deliver him figs. He found none, and he said, henceforth, no man shall eat from thee. And the tree became useless, and by the next morning it was dead. Okay? Because God is God. He is eternal.
with him. Have you ever heard of this is the season of God? He has no seasons. Whatever he places a demand upon your life, you have no reason not to give whatever he has placed on your life. His disciples did not understand. When he said it, they just thought to themselves, this man has come again, no? Why is he cursing the tree? It's not supposed to have figs at this time. Don't ever limit what God can do. Amen? And the agency through whom he will do it. Amen? But the next morning when they saw the tree was dead, they had to draw his attention to it and say, isn't this the tree that you cursed? And he said, this is a matter of your faith. It's a problem of your faith. You have too little faith to believe the word that I spoke yesterday. You thought I was just delirious. Amen? But here's something about ministry. The ministry covering I want you to take home. It comes from the story in Matthew chapter 8, verses 5 to 10. If you're at work and you believe that the work you're doing is of God, then this is important for you to take note of. Matthew chapter 8, from verse 5 to 10. And when Jesus was entered into Capernaum, there came unto him a centurion. A centurion is one who has 100 soldiers under his authority, beseeching him and saying, Lord, my servant lieth at home, sick of the palsy, grievously tormented. And Jesus saith unto him, I will come and heal him. Now, the Jews, they would have said, Jesus, can you come to my house? And so Jesus expected that they wanted to see him come. Nobody had ever told Jesus, apart from the woman who had an issue of blood, she didn't even need to talk to Jesus. She just said, all I need to do is touch his clothes. Not even him, just his clothes is enough to transmit his power into my body and heal me. Nobody had ever come to Jesus and said, you can heal me without, just give a word. But this centurion, who is not a Jew, he's not of Israel, he answered and said, Lord, I am not worthy. I am not worthy that thou shouldest come under my roof, but speak the word only, and my servant shall be healed. Wow. For I am a man under authority. He did not say, I am a man in authority over others. He said, I am a man under authority, because until you learn how to be under authority, you will not succeed at being over authority, an authority over people. And I say to this man, go. See, he says, I am under authority. That is why I am able to say to one, go, and to another, come. If I wasn't under authority, it would be futile. Amen. Do this and he doeth it. And when Jesus heard it, he marveled and said to them that followed, verily, verily, I say unto you, I have not found so great faith. No, not in Israel. Now, here's the thing about authority and the ministry covering. Let me have you four guys in the choir. Can you just come out? Now, I like jacket, so he will be Augustus Caesar. So you stand here, Augustus Caesar, you come. So you stand here now, in front, face him. You come and stand behind him, and you stand behind him. Can I have four other men? Four other men. Volunteers, or I volunteer you. Okay, the four of you in that room. There's a visitation on the choir right now. There's one more. Four, good. Stand behind him. Now, this
is Augustus Caesar's written instruction to the soldiers he has in Jerusalem. This here is the centurion, okay? Because this one is over all of them. This one probably has a few thousands under him. This one less, but this is your centurion, the centurion, okay. He's the centurion. So Augustus gives the order. Pass it on to him. Pass it on to the one behind you. And 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 the one behind you. You're keeping some of it. So what Augustus does passes all the way down the line of authority. Why? Because they are all in alignment. They are all in alignment. Okay? Now, centurion, you step outside here. Now, once he steps out, all the other three step out as well. There is no longer alignment. What Augustus says does not reach the end. Now, these four have stepped out of the covering of Augustus. You understand? And because they're no longer covered by Augustus, anything that happens to them, Augustus is not going to send his protection. Amen? That's what it's like in ministry. Whatever, if you're at work, and you know you're doing what God has committed into your hands to do, unless you stay in alignment, you're not covered. Okay? In fact, what will happen is Augustus will soon discover that they have moved out of alignment. And what does he do? He sends him to go and deal with them and replace them. Come back into alignment quickly. Quickly, quickly. But while they're in alignment, they are covered. Thank you, guys. A ministry covering comes over us as we walk in alignment. It's one of the great lacks in the body of Christ, and by extension in our nation, is the spirit of the Father. Okay? In many ways, Augustus was a father. I have come across people in this nation who have children, but the biology is all that you will find. They do not behave like fathers to their children. A father wants to empower his children so that his children will do what he was unable to do. Amen? And so we need to really see the return of fathers. It's a very important concept to God. In the book of Malachi, the very last thing he said in the Old Testament is, I will restore the fathers and the sons. If that restoration doesn't happen, it'll bring a curse on the earth. And so I often tell fathers that, you know, it's not about putting food on the table. It's important, and I think that's a responsibility that God gives more of to fathers than to mothers, but it is about playing a part in the lives of your children. Because it doesn't matter what you say. If a man is an alcoholic and beats his wife when he's drunk, his son may, as a child, resent it, but one day his son will do exactly the same thing. Because the father mentors him through his good or his bad. Amen. Let me stop there. So, I've talked about different coverings. And I pray, if you've made notes, if you've taken them down, begin to walk under the coverings of God. in every aspect of your life, the devil will have trouble getting through to you. Amen? Because you've closed all the gaps in the hedge. Amen? Learn to love. Love one another. Loving one another does not mean that you're a mundu. That people can just walk over you. And really, God sometimes makes us into floor mats so that people can clean their feet on us and get into the house. Amen? But that doesn't make you a fool. It's not foolish to love. It's godly to love. Amen? And when you show love, my God, you know, unfortunately, sometimes it's only at people's funerals that we hear about the love that they show. Rest assured that if you are a loving person, God will raise people that will love you.